Good afternoon, everyone. I am Abhishek Kumar Singh, search engineer at Unbxd. And today, I'll be talking about schema learning in Apache Solr. Well, it's a feature we built at Unbxd, and we are working towards contributing it to Solr. About Unbxd, so well, we are an e-commerce search recommendation and discovery platform. We host the catalog of e-commerce companies in our multi-tenant search cluster. We use signals and machine learnings for recommendations. And our search consists of various open source stacks like Apache Solr, Elasticsearch, Storm, Kafka, Apache Spark, and all. So moving on to the main agenda, I'll be first talking about the motivation behind the schema learning framework, the main objectives that we focus in the solution that we offer, in the what schema learning framework is all about, and the various inference modes that it supports. There'll be a couple of demos, and the conclusion, and the future roadmap. So talking about the motivation, well, it all comes from how schema-less mode in Solr and Elasticsearch by default works. So I'll go ahead with the example of indexing these two documents in schema-less Solr. So as the first document indexes, the first thing that Solr does is it creates a schema based on the values that it encounters in the first document. So as we could see, price got long, and prod ID was a field that got a date type because it looked something like a date. And then this data was persisted into Lucene index. Now when we move on to the second document, the first thing that Solr does is validation based on the schema that it just created. And what happens is schema failed. Why? Because it expects a date type in the prod ID. There's one more thing that happens in this case is, even if prod ID had a date type and it would have got indexed, the data in the price, that is 178.77, would have been truncated to 178. It's because since the first document price looked like a long, it will always index something which is long into Lucene index. Once something is indexed into Lucene, there's no going back. So I don't know if that's right or wrong, but it doesn't fulfill most of our use cases. So that was the whole motivation of why we had to think of something which is not schema-less indexing, but schema learning. So these are the objectives that we are looking forward to. We want to help generate a schema that is data-driven, meaning that it should be tightly coupled with the data that we are going to index without involving any manual effort. The data-driven schema should infer optimal types, meaning that all the types a field needs to support should be taken care of. We should also be able to infer semantic types. By semantic types, I mean special classification names given to the attributes of the documents, which can be very domain context. For example, for e-commerce, fashion e-commerce, color, pattern, and title types can be really important attributes, and it can be a really important task to actually identify those attributes in a new catalog as a multi-tenant. Similarly, for auto-part e-commerce, your make and model types can be really important. So, so with these objectives in mind, this is what we... So schema learning framework is what we propose. This is basically, this framework helps in generating the schema without indexing. This learns from the document and tries to generate a schema which is tightly coupled with the document, with all the documents of the corpus. And the schema which is generated out of it can actually be used for indexing. This needs offline training because, as I mentioned, documents are indexed in Lucene. Once they're indexed in Lucene, there's no going back. The times can't really be changed. So you have to infer the types once after looking at all the data, and then only you have to start indexing. So what is it all about? This framework is basically, it helps you define configurations, define hierarchies, and then infer upon the most optimal schema. These are the two modes that it actually supports, primitive and regular expression-based inference, and machine learning model-based inference. I'll be talking about both the modes one by one. So in primitive or regular expression-based inference mode, you have to define a type hierarchy sort of a structure where you actually define which type should be assigned to a particular field if it has to support n number of other types. As a very simple example, if a field has to support both long and double, you should assign it double. Now, this configuration can go as complex as you want. And You can also define regular expressions to identify certain fields which cannot really be inferred from normal classes. We'll look at examples in the next slides. So the type hierarchy I was talking about can look something like this, very similar to this. If we are just talking about primitive types. Now, if we define a few regular expressions and add them to the type hierarchy, this is what it would look. I'm going to explain this. So basically, if there is a field that is going to support double and long, it should be assigned double. And if there is a field in which we have seen both date and Boolean and double as well, it means that it's neither of the three. It's actually a text. Then only it is having all the types of data. Going on a bit more complex level, if we have so if we define regular expressions for, say, link URL and image URL, and there is a field in which half of the documents were having image URL and rest half of them are having image URL, half of them are having image URL and rest half of them are having simple URLs, it can't be called an image URL, it's a simple URL. So basically, the hierarchy can look like this. This kind of a configuration can be purely purely specific to your business use case. For example, you may want to analyze them differently, or in some cases, you may want to cache the images into your CDN and not the normal links. So basically, only those fields will be cached, which are basically purely image. So the XML configuration for this will look something like this. This can be broken into three parts. We'll look at them at one by one. So the first part looks something like this. This is nothing but a normal mapping between the Java types and the Solr, how we call them in Solr. So this has been motivated from the configuration of the current schema-less mode in Solr. The second part of it is where we define the regular expressions. So the image that I showed there, so for image, we had three regular expressions. This is how we can identify. So this is how we can configure. And the third part is basically where you define the tree. The tree structure that I showed you can be defined by XML using this in the schema learning framework. So this is exactly what the tree showed, basically the hierarchy. Now, so once we have configured using this, I have a demonstration to actually show how it works. So we'll start off with creation of a collection. So I have named it sample collection one, and the config name that I have given it is schema-learn. So basically, this is the config set which has all those configurations I talked about. And after this, well, it already existed. Let us see. Okay. So it has zero documents. Now, what I want to do is, I have some documents with me that I want to index in it. So, however, this gives me an error. Unknown field title, because the field was not known. Basically, all the fields of this document are new. But that is how Solr gives us the error that, OK, title is unknown. So so what we can actually do is, instead of simply indexing them, we can train the schema with this data. The same data has been put here. And I'm hitting the train APIs. So after we have used enough documents to train the schema, we can actually look at what it has to offer. So we get something like this. This one says that these fields were added, and these are the optimal types. So if we look at a few of them, for example, this production description in the... So this is one of those examples I gave you. In one of the documents, it had an image, and the other one, it had a normal link, which is not an image. And as per the hierarchy, it sat into the image. So it was given an image. Now, we got this. What can we do with this? This can readily be used in the add schema API. So after this schema has been added, one more thing. All this while when we were using the documents to train the schema, they have not got indexed. The number of products is still zero. Now, when we have actually created the index and using the add schema API, we have added them to the schema. Now, let us see if we can index them. Looks like we did. Let us see if that reflected in the documents or not. I see they did. So basically, this was the step. We could first train our schema with all the documents, then create the schema, then index the documents. It's just like schema-less. It's just that it's lazy indexing. So basically, you don't get so many errors. You create the index first, schema first, and then the index. So this is the part that we have. We are working on, and the patch is there in the Jira. So now there's a second phase to it. So you can also, in the future, this framework is also going to support pluggability of machine learning models to identify types. So why do we need it? Because there are certain types, let us call them semantic types. These are those types which can't really be inferred through a regular expression or normal classes. So for example, this, and they can be very domain context, as I gave example previously. So such types can only be inferred when you have something like a learning model. If you have a previous corpus and you have identified certain mapping of this sort, and you want to plug it into this framework, this will be available. So so this part will help us figure out semantic type inference. And it can be trained in any way that you want at Unbxd. So in one of our products, we are actually using it. We have not written it in a way that it can be committed to Solr as of now, but we are looking forward to committing it to Solr as well. At Unbxd, what we do is we train our models with pre-annotated judgments and query performance analysis data. So this pre-annotated judgment is basically all the previous sites that we had, and manually their types were mapped to certain types. Their fields were mapped to certain types, the types which actually made sense. Those data have been taken up, and our models have been trained with them. This query performance analysis logs are basically based on the previous click streams and how a query performed and where, which in which all field what kind of query actually matches. This data was curated into query analysis data, and a model was trained. That was about the data part. About the algorithm, the recurrent neural network worked pretty fine for us. It was because for us, or in such cases, the sequence really matters. So it's the contextual learning that recurrent neural network brings with itself actually fit in the use case of Unbxd, and we were able to get pretty much confidence in the models that we trained and inferring types. I have a small demonstration about that as well. So I'll try to create another collection here. OK, that one exists. Really good. And I have some data that looks like this. There's a difference between this data and the data I demonstrated previously. Here, the field names are like black boxes for us. I do not really know what these field names belong to or what they stand for, because it's a new catalog and I am a multi-tenant. So I would want to identify what these values look like. So I'll train this. And when I want to know what did my training model inferred out of this data, this is the kind of output that I can get. It says that in field one, it saw title, something that looked like a title four times, something that looked like a brand once. So in field three, in all the five documents, it saw color. And in field two, it saw brand in all the five documents. Let us look at the documents again. So this is how our field one field 3 and field 2 look like? So this inference will be purely based on how your model has been trained, how well it has been trained, on how much data have you trained it, and what kind of algorithms have you used. This works. On a few of the models that we have, as I mentioned, they are purely context specific, and we have several sites which belong to multiple contexts. So we trained it differently, and it performs differently. However, the core crux part that can be taken from here is this framework should support the pluggability of this model, and that can be a really important aspect about it. So from here on, I think I reached the conclusion. So schema learning framework was something that that stands as a framework inside the Solr that helps us infer types based on certain rules based on learning, and the main goal remains at automated creation of accurate schema. This is how the roadmap looks like. This Jira is the main Jira where you'll find all the patches, all the discussions, and you can contribute to the discussions. I must mention Hossman. I think it was his original idea. A few years back, I found another Jira in which he was talking about it when we faced such kind of a problem last year in November. So in the phase one, the framework, the main framework, the primitive types and rejects inference will be committed. And we are looking forward to phase two, where the model inference pluggability can be committed as well. This is my team. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Abhishek. Are there any questions?
Hello. So I have a question about the actual taking the fields and mapping them to actual field types. Is there a way to plug in queries into that and say you want to be able to select, instead of just having text fields, have text fields or string fields and base it on the way that the users are using it through queries?
Yes, so I think we are doing some kind of that sort. So the time, at the moment we start training the data, apart from the annotated data that we are using, we also use previous query logs, the way it performed, and the fields in which it actually matched inside Solr. And all those analytics is brought into consideration, and we use that data as well for training our models. So yes, I mean, it's not there in the framework, but the way you train the model, I think that is how we can do.
Hello. So are you aware of similar initiatives on top of Elasticsearch, or is your solution could work on top of Elasticsearch? Does it has some meaning for that?
Right. Yeah. So this contribution, all the code that about this framework that goes, everything goes into the update request processor pipeline. So that's a feature in Solr where you can actually configure how every update goes through. As in, you can define the chain through which your update should go through. I'm not really sure we can define this in Elasticsearch or not. If we can, I don't think this model can. It'll be very different. It'll be very difficult to ship it to Elasticsearch. But as of now, I don't think there is a way to configure the update something like an update request processor chain in Elasticsearch.
So last question, is it okay, Christoph? Yeah, you can talk after.
Quick question about the data. I presume the data you have is already in a certain format. Is it able to distinguish with random data, so if there's a case sensitivity issue, so would it know title versus title in a different casing and other examples of that?
Well, in this inference, all those kinds, so basically I'll bring you to the initial problems that we had. So some of them are very simple, as in distinguishing a title from a description, product description. This second set of problems that we had were basically distinguishing several kind of categories. So what I mean by several kind of categories is that certain things can belong to multiple levels of categories, while the words which is used to describe them look exactly similar. So in those cases, we had to go with some approaches that you talked about. We had to ignore case sensitivity. We had to ignore, you know, sometimes the length of it. Sometimes we had to truncate it. Sometimes we had to, you know, break it into multiple fields and all. So yes, we encountered cases related to that. Do I answer your question? Well, we don't do that, basically. I think what you are asking, yeah. We don't look at that aspect of it.
Yeah. So, because we run out of time, thank you very much, and thank you for your questions.
Thank you.